Welcome back to Trending in Education. Dan Strafford, Brandon Jones, and Michael Palmer with you. And today we're talking about South by Southwest, more specifically South by Southwest EDU. Brandon was out there. The whole festival completed this past Sunday, but EDU a couple of weeks back. And Brandon, you're out there. You're experiencing what are trends in education, right? Initial reactions that can obviously foster a much larger discussion here on today's podcast. But what was it like being immersed in the that two or three days out there?
Yeah, it was great. It was a good conference. I've had the chance to talk to you guys a little bit, and hopefully in today's show, you'll some more things of interest will come up for all three of us, not just for me, but a little bit of framing. So it was 4 days of conference. So it started on Monday, I guess a couple Mondays past now, and ran through Thursday. Thursday was sort of a stub day, went to just about 2:30. Three different, it's a huge event, thousands upon thousands of attendees, three main facilities, Austin Convention Center, plus two other hotels. And so just a ton of sessions happening, a lot of sessions happening concurrently. So that's one of the fun games in the conferences, which of these things. I can only be in one place at one time,
right?
But I did travel in a pack. We had a good showing, a good crew from Kaplan.
Nice.
So we covered a whole lot of ground. And so obviously I sort of have the most intimate experience with the sessions that I was in, but I got a pretty good sense of a lot of sessions that were running throughout the 4 days.
The zeitgeist. You got a sense of the zeitgeist?
I was plugged right into the zeitgeist.
Yeah.
I knew what was trending.
That's important.
In Austin at South by Southwest. A couple other things just real quick before we get into it. South by Southwest EDU, the shorthand for it when you write it is Sxsw Edu.
Yes.
Which I heard people try to say... Sxsw Edu,
yeah,
which is much harder, even though shorter.
It's a challenging initialism.
But the Sxs, you gotta also make sure you're saying it right, because there's some traps
it's almost
in there.
Like sex is sweeter.
Yes. See, but even in hearing that sounds.
It sounds kind of sexy.
Not like what we're going for.
Right.
So that was a thing. The locals, the veterans called just South By.
I heard that.
South By EDU.
Right. Because the guy, Sai, shout out to Sai, who was out there from my side. His band camp now is South By.
It's pretty good.
He likes to say, well, when I was at South By.
Yeah.
And it's just, if you say South By, like ...
Yeah.
The rest of us are like, ooh.
Yeah. It shows that you're in. It shows that you're, it's othering a little bit to people who don't know. But it shows that you're in the know.
Sure. Yeah. Those of you who did not attend. You can listen carefully to what Brandon says on the show and then start to act like you were there.
Yeah.
And say, when I was at South By, and then, paraphrase Brandon.
You know, like they say to athletes, like act like you've been there before.
Yes.
Just like act like you've been there at all. Like you don't have to have been. just act like you have.
Nice.
Some background for those who don't know about South by Southwest. It started in 1987 out there in Austin, Texas, and was focused initially on media, music, and film. And so it has expanded over the past few years to include this sort of kickoff conference, which focuses on education. And then a lot of that spills over into the typical or whatever word you want to use, South by Southwest conference that focuses more on film, interactive media now, digital media and the like as it grows and grows. But Brandon, safe to assume there's a lot of cross sections there, right? Between the two worlds of education in the first 4 days and then the digital and interactive and media stuff in the second 4 day set. I'm sure you saw a lot of cross section and cross pollination of information between the two.
Yeah, the rock stars start to show up when the nerds leave.
Way of life.
To rub some elbows. I mean, it's digital is throughout, and media, entertainment. Like there is a bridge. I mean, we talked about it on this pod. Edutainment. The word edutainment.
Yeah, baby.
Texting my co-host Mike Palmer. I was like. There are people who are saying that they are edutainers here.
God bless them.
There are people. That was a word that actually was used by multiple presenters in multiple sessions.
Yep.
So yeah, there's a lot of bridges, at this conference, which I think is part of what, as a participant, made it so exciting. Is you're getting, you know, a lot of cross pollination, a lot of different interdisciplinary interaction. I think that the intersections of a lot of those places where they touch, that's where a lot of the cool stuff really happens.
And maybe next year, one of these coming years, we're gonna do a podcast from.
I'm ready to bring my mic, conference, Palmer, right? With me.
Like what you did there. I see that. Yes,
it's gonna be good. I could just like all the things that I'm saying now.
Yeah,
I could have said then. Even more from Austin.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. Not to mention the food trucks are delicious.
Yes. The food trucks. That was an interesting thing. The food trucks really rolled out in force for the post EDU crowd.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I was like, during EDU, I was like, oh, look, there's a food truck. And as I was getting on my way to the airport, I was like,
the caravan went by.
Convoy.
Exactly.
Convoy.
So, but it was good. If I may, Dan, you know, we've just over the last couple of weeks talked about our March Madness bracket, which, sure. Again, get your votes in, see who you think should be moving on in the tourney.
Interestingly, that was trending at South by.
It
right?
was. Yeah. It sure was. Yeah. The trending in education, a March Madness bracket.
It was a recursive trend, which made it even more, apropos.
But I think so in thinking about this, as I was there, I think 13 of our 16 were referenced, and most of which were referenced many times. Like that was definitely on trend. I didn't get any digital humanities hipster.
Yes.
I didn't get any expeditionary learning, although that could have been one.
Thank goodness.
And and we didn't hear about the Gartner hype cycle, although I think
you were soaking in it.
We were soaking in it. Yes, yeah. That was the meta. That one was absolutely was
that was
present.
Your like next level game.
Yeah,
you
sure.
Were talking hype index.
I was.
You were like, let's think about what you're talking about.
Right.
Because actually,
and who's going to be talking about it? Where is it going to be on the curve?
There's a construct.
Are you troughing?
I'm dropping.
You troughing, bro?
I'm dropping a construct on you.
So, but it was, it felt good. Like this is a little humble brag here, but I feel like we, listeners, if you've been listening all this while, like you've been hearing the thing. So you basically did go to South by listeners.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, this really is, all joking aside here. This, the stuff that we've been, you know, sort of working through and you know, bringing to the pod, grappling with that those are the things that are being talked about in education, ed tech.
We're tapped into the zeitgeist.
Yeah,
I'm gonna hashtag zeitgeist.
Yeah,
all right, I got a lot of zeitgeist.
Run that one back.
Yeah,
you got you like the zeitgeist.
I think that's all I got. Yeah. Zeitgeist.
One of the things I saw more of a South by Southwest tweet, not necessarily about EDU, but I'm sure it stemmed over, was, and it's a technology not specific to education, but just a reaction from you, Brent, I'd love, is about Uber and Lyft not being in Austin. And I believe Austinians, or I don't know what.
Austinites.
Austinites. They have voted to not have it. Like, they've basically said, you are not allowed in our town, from what I've read. Correct me if I'm wrong, if you know differently. But was it a trouble? Was it a step back for having to hail a cab or rent a car, in your estimation, as I saw so many complain?
2003. So what they have, Uber being Uber and Lyft free, is the headline. But they have something called Ride Austin. Mm. And Ride Austin is a not-for-profit, where it uses the same, I actually don't know how, hopefully I'm not blowing up your spot, right, Austin, but it uses like the same interface, like actually the same UI as Uber. Mm-hmm. It's like, has a different, you know, logo.
It's
on
like
your
white labeled Uber.
Yeah. So you click in and it's friggin' Uber, man.
Right.
And, so you're in it. And it you know, you put in where you're going and they take you there and it charges you credit. It's the same thing.
Same deal.
You can choose to round up your fare, and the rounding will go to a local charity in Austin.
That's nice.
So I think I think people who didn't get, I guess under the hood is maybe too on the nose for a car metaphor.
Sometimes you want to be too on the nose.
Yeah, but for people who just heard the headline of there is no, you know, no Lyft and no Uber and didn't find out what the alternatives were, that is probably a bummer. But I took Ride Austin a couple times and found it to be as reliable, and it basically it was the same experience as a user.
Yeah, I mean, Uber is also such a lightning rod right now that any story related to Uber is going to get picked up.
Can you imagine just recently you had to like walk out onto the street not knowing if a car was going to come pick you up and be like, where? Yeah, put your this is going digital, like thumbs in the air trying to say,
I see what you did.
Where will someone please come get me? So like, what a barbarians, we were.
Crazy. How would people survive?
I don't know. But like that, people are, we're still surviving, but no longer because there's this other solution.
What a relief.
Yeah.
Thank goodness. Some of the articles I saw, Brandon, being there and immersed, I wonder if you got the same inclination. You made the mention that there wasn't anything about digital hipsters, talking about, you know, A Hipster Learns in Brooklyn, an episode we had a while back. I did notice in one article from educationdive.com that they mentioned that one of the major discussion points was liberal arts and liberal arts potentially needing a rebranding of sorts. And that was one of the big discussion points they saw on the Wednesday of EDU across a couple of different panels. Did you see that as a major topic? And we've talked about it here on the show. Do you think that is, you know, part of the discussion for education move forward, almost the marketing of it, the rebranding and the renaming of certain things to make them more viable in the future of education?
Yeah, I do. And our faithful listeners will know my long problemed pronunciation of liberal arts. I nailed it. We were about to high five.
Almost high five, but the audio might have been weird.
Yeah. I think so. So I'll answer that sort of obliquely, Dan. But there was a lot of talk about design. Human-centered design and having interdisciplinary tracks where design sort of sits at the nexus of a lot of things. Mm-hmm. My favorite speaker for the entire session, which I actually want to share some quotes of his later in a I heard these things at South By bit, was this guy John Maeda. Is like human genius, actually, I'll talk more about him. He was profound. But you know, to all of that is filed under language matters, and whether there's a rebranding needed for liberal arts or whether, you know, there's just, it needs to find its way through, you know, through the art that already exists into things like STEAM. Mm-hmm. I think, yes, there was more of that in this conference than I was expecting. And I was happy to see it.
And STEAM is science, technology, engineering, arts, and math.
And men, right? I like that joke every time. It's good.
Never let it go. Yeah.
Yeah. Math. It is. That's correct. That's right. It just puts the A in STEM,
which is important. I mean, because creativity and the arts, particularly as things get automated, you know, we haven't talked about robots yet. I'm sure you're gonna come back to that, right?
So I was hoping that someone would ask me about bots. I've been waiting all show actually to talk about robots.
Yeah,
they're here, gentlemen. That's the headline. So we went to a good session with one of the guys from Georgia State University, which we've talked about on the show before. They're using chatbots to address a term I hadn't heard before, MELT, which is a percentage of students who accept admission to matriculate and then never in the spring and then never show up in the fall. So that's the summer MELT. Mm. At Georgia State, it was as high as 18%, which is both big business to Georgia State and you know, really impacting the futures for those you know, would have been matriculants. So they're using chatbots and it's cool. Their mascot at Georgia State is a panther or a leopard or some kind of big cat.
Yeah.
And so it is not an anthropomorphized bot. It is a zoomorphized bot named Pounce.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. And Pounce is there to answer all your questions, whether it be about filing your FAFSA or about is there parking at Georgia State.
Does Pounce look like a cat?
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Looks like a cat. Yeah. Purple cat.
Nice.
Yeah. And so it's a learning, and so machine learning was also a big theme, and obviously that's behind a lot of the bot technology. The machines would learn with more input from their human pals, overlords, perhaps future underlings.
Right.
And at the end, the human, the Pounce was answering 98% of all requests that came in.
Yeah.
All chats that came in.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was a randomly controlled trial, and with 3,000 participants in both sides. Mm-hmm. Really, it's cool data. It's a demonstrable, like big ends.
Yeah, yeah.
For the big cat, demonstrably better results from the one that had more engagement, and it's all text message engagement. Also, I should say.
Interesting. Yeah. Are there any cases where there's like a jump ball between Pounce and a human, and Pounce just pounces on it?
Gets there first. No, so Pounce will serve up.
Yeah.
To the human whenever Pounce doesn't know. So Pounce either has the ball or tells you he needs some help with the ball.
So Pounce knows when to dish and when to finish his own. Yeah.
But Pounce,
or her own. Yeah.
Pounce is so much Pounce here, by the way. Georgia State, who knew?
Yeah.
But Pounce is it's like AI, more AI, which is part of what's driving Pounce.
Yeah.
Is the answer.
Right.
And more of a ball hog even than Allen Iverson, which I was trying to just draw in there as well.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it takes 98% of the shots.
Yeah, yeah. And you have to train it for a long time. It takes a lot of practice.
Yeah, a lot of practice. Are you talking about practice, Mike?
Yeah, I am.
So robots were good. I mentioned John Maeda earlier. On the other side, I wanted to offer a point of his. So he was asked, so his session, I just got to do just a little shout to his session. So his session was on design trends in technology.
Okay.
The Design Trends in Technology Report 2017. So we go there and I was with one of my colleagues and we were call it 250 people in the room. And he comes out and he says, so I'm only like 50% done with my report. So I don't think we're going to talk about that much today. And he proceeds to sit down and put his cell phone number up on the screen and say, but I'm happy to talk about whatever. So just text me if you have questions and I'll just sit here until they come in. And we were like, is this a prank at first? But his the humanity of the guy, John Maeda.
Interesting.
MIT grad, was on the MIT faculty, was the president of RISD, the Rhode Island School of Design.
Okay.
Works in the private sector now as a head of design. Just really, really incredible. But he was asked, one of the questions that was texted to him was, do you see a future of classrooms without teachers? Mm-hmm. Which I thought was apropos for, we've sort of had this conversation.
Yeah.
He was pretty emphatic in saying no. Mm-hmm. So I think, there are things that he told this really touching story about a teacher who had changed his life by going to his parents' tofu shop and saying, you can't have John work the tofu shop in the summer because he needs to get a college credit class so he can go on to MIT, and this, really having changed his life. And, computers can't do that for you.
Right.
That was his point, which was really touching. Mm-hmm. But there are going to be places where robots are replacing our work. Mm-hmm. And there'll be places where they won't.
Yeah. I think upcoming show, we're going to talk about the future of work with Dr. Broer Sxsw, our chief learning officer at Kaplan. Similar themes, though, at least in terms of the tease for that. It's a similar concept where, the AI and the agents that are going to be added to our learning experiences are going to make a lot of the stuff that we do today better and easier to do, but it's not really going to remove the need for humans to connect with other humans.
Yeah.
So it sounds like that's kind of consistent with what Mr. Maeda.
Yeah.
Dr. Maeda?
I think he's just John Maeda.
Nice.
So John Maeda, one of the questions that he was asked is, so these are things I heard at South By. Mm. This is your new bit brought to you by me.
Nice.
So here's a quote. So he was asked, what is the meaning of life?
Yeah.
It's a pretty good question.
Fair question.
It was that kind of session though.
Yeah.
It was real, like
deep.
It was deep. It was spiritual.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was good. He said the meaning of life is to be able to engage with each other in real time.
Interesting.
Yeah.
The real time aspect is interesting.
Yeah. He said, this is real life. This is the meaning of life. It's happening right now.
But would that mean that like snaps that I send you don't count unless they're in real time?
I think he would say that it is, that's fun, but it's, that's not the deeper, not the meaning of life.
Nice.
Yeah. Other things, I'm going to come back to John Maeda. Other things I heard, another teaser for the episode with Dr. Brewer Saxberg, 45% of U.S. jobs will be replaced by robots in 20 years.
Wow.
So if you are, you know, look to your left, look to your right.
Yeah.
All three of you are going to be replaced by robots. one of those kinds of things.
Although I'm hoping that this will allow us to retire early and have a lot of robots tend to our every whim at the assisted living.
Yeah. The post-work world.
Yeah.
Could be interesting. Here's another. This is still in the things I heard at SAFTA.
Yeah, yeah.
Digital education is no less important to our future than renewable energy. That's big.
That's big.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Talking about the amount of, so there is $8 billion spent on ed tech and there's $8 billion spent on gaming. And ed tech is, or education, the overall spend on education is 57 times bigger.
Yep.
So, you know, people talk about the ed tech bubble, and I think the person slinging this fact is an ed tech and so maybe has a vested interest in not bursting, but you know, there's a case to be made that there's much more to invest in there. Okay, more John Maeda. I'm bringing it home with a couple John Maedas here. He talked a lot about having a Yoda.
Sure.
So the Yoda in his life, so he was defining it as a Yoda as someone who is much more senior than you and who sees that you have the keys and they have the doors.
I like that.
It's pretty nice.
That is.
He was then asked, how did he find his Yoda? And he said, I read in books and saw who was still alive, and I went and saw them.
Interesting.
That was his answer. He was asked about who his Yoda are, and he said most of his Yoda are dead. But that's part of like when you choose someone who is much more senior than you, like
unless
that's an occupational hazard.
Unless like Skywalker, you choose somebody of another species,
right?
Gonna live
when 900 years you are.
Did he mention at all, Brendan, the transition from seeking a Yoda to becoming a Yoda for someone else?
Yeah, it's a good question. He was not asked that, and so he didn't answer it. Someone did ask if he would be their Yoda. That was one of the texts that he was sent. He said, "Aw." Two other things. Three other things. You can choose, Dan, what to keep here, what to bag.
It's all gold.
Yeah.
Gold, he said,
there's a difference between a startup and an art project. It's just the scale is different. I liked that.
I like the art angle. So
yeah,
it's like he's an art and design guy.
So
really.
He is an art and design guy. While he was on the faculty at MIT, he went to Sloan. He got his MBA. He was then the head, you know, the president of RISD. So,
sure.
He's an academic, and administrator. But yeah, he is art that is featured in the permanent collection of the San Francisco MoMA. So he's like a legit artist.
So it's kind of like the art side of liberal arts.
Yeah, although all of his artwork that I saw anyway, I went sort of deep on John Maeda after this. It was in 40 years the most inspiring speaker I've ever seen.
I think he'd be a nice get for the show. You have his number.
Yeah, I do have his number. I was texting him.
Yeah.
He answered one of my questions. He didn't answer the question that I got in sort of towards the end when he was already having hundreds come in. I was trying to ask him if he had a favorite R, VR, AR, MR, or just regular R.
TR? You didn't ask him about TR? Tactile reassurance?
No, just stop.
R&R?
Yeah, or R&R. R&R is pretty good.
R&R is pretty good.
He might have gotten there. He said, he was asked about what are his regrets. And he said, I don't have many regrets because at the edge of where I thought I was going to have regrets, I chose not to have regrets.
Whoa. Is he levitating while he was doing it?
He basically was.
It sounds like we sit in Lotus style floating above the stage.
Yeah, I mean, like, that's not actually far off from the experience. Yeah, I mean, he was sitting there in the center of the stage in a chair with a PowerPoint presentation. I didn't see him have water.
Wow.
He had these little round spectacles that he would remove and then put back on sort of contemplatively. Mm. And he had...
Not Snapchat spectacles.
Right? No.
You're talking about regular...
Reg specs.
Okay.
And he had a PowerPoint up, which would alternate between, you know, like a wide, you know, sort of different shots of him for on video, and then just his cell phone number. Like, that was his he had one slide in his PowerPoint. But that was incredible. Last item, he said he was telling about a conversation he once had where someone told him that when you eat together, you become the same person.
Yeah.
You know, because you're like, you're consuming the same thing that then becomes part of your, you know, breaks down into ATP, et cetera. Like, it gets written into you. You are what you eat. If you eat the same thing, you are the same person.
Although I heard he recommended sharing plates.
That's right. Anyway, it was, I heavied up on the herd around South by him, but, yeah, just to wrap it from my point of view, it was a really good 4 days. We had a good contingent. Sai was great.
Yeah.
Good contingent there. Austin's a fun city.
It is.
I think big things are happening and happening faster than even I, who've tried to stay attuned, have perceived them to be happening. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if there's a single takeaway, it's probably that is the future is already here, just in sort of different pockets, for different and in different products. Mm-hmm. And that's going to just become more and more the present over time.
Yeah. And it's all the more reason to continue to look outward and figure out where there are those opportunities.
Absolutely.
To kind of snap into what's happening. That's awesome. That's great. You went
next year, Training and Education live from South by Southwest EDU.
I reserved the booth.
You just put a stake down with our flags flying from it.
Get in early.
Brandon, awesome stuff. And as we go and I find more articles or follow-ups on South by Southwest EDU, I'll be sure to share them on Twitter and on Facebook and over on the blog as well, trendingand.com. We'll have Dr. Bror Sxsw, coming up in the next couple of episodes. Bror has a large understanding of education and education technology and learning engineering, which I'm really interested to be a listener on the next couple of podcasts to really dig into what Bror has to say. So that's coming up. And you also can continue to vote on our March Madness bracket. That is over on our Twitter page. You can vote and see who moves on to the next round. And ultimately, you will help crown the champion of the Trending in Education March Madness bracket. 16 teams enter. One team leaves, one topic leaves, and that is our champion for 2017. With all that said, thanks so much for listening to Trending in Education. We'll check you back here next time.